بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending immense greetings and salutations upon the final Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, we find unfortunately as Muslims that many of us begin to stay away from certain realities or a specific reality whereby we become keen individuals to discuss various topics, whether it be topics of the worldly politics around us, or topics talking about other individuals, or to be worried about a certain situation or certain individual, as we find is common practice. And we have many things to discuss. But when it comes to another reality, which all of us have to face in our lives, we find very rarely a person begins to focus and begins to prepare for the end of this reality or the end of this short span upon this earth. Maybe possibly some of us have fallen into the trap or fallen into the prophecy of the prophetic tradition of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, the hadith in the Sunan of Abi Dawood, that there will come a time whereby this ummah will be suffering from al-wahan. They pose the question, what is this wahan, what is this disease that us Muslims, I quote Muslims, not non-Muslims, will begin to suffer. In the context of the hadith is talking about the Muslim ummah. They'll be suffering from hubbu dunya وَكَرَاهَةُ الْمَوْتِ أَوْ كَرَاهِيَةُ الْمَوْتِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمَ. This Muslim Ummah will begin to suffer from a love of this world and a hatred for death. This Ummah will begin to despise that reality of that journey, that return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is quite strange when we are supposed to be an Ummah, a nation, an individual preparing ourselves to make that return and that journey back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know that there are numerous verses inside the Quran, either direct or indirect, which begin to talk or send home the reality of this reality. Whether it be directly, kullu nafsin da'ikatul maut, every single soul will taste death, which occurs in three separate locations inside the Quran. And inshallah we're going to ponder over these three main verses. Whether it be other metaphors or descriptions about death, ألهاكم التكاثر حتى زرتم المقابر. The continuous piling and rivalry of this dunya, of this world, distracts you until you visit the graves. This is a form of kinaya, of speech in the Arabic language, carrying the meaning when you go and visit the graves, meaning when you are dead. When you are dead individual, that is the only time the mutual rivalry of this world will be taken away from you. Thus you find in the hadith that the son of Adam had one valley of gold, he would aspire to have another valley of gold. And the only thing that would quench that thirst and that desire will be the dirt, the dust, the turab, which will be thrown or stuffed into his mouth. Likewise, we find other words inside the Quran, whether it be musiba, the calamity, whether it be the ajal, the appointed time, the certainty, the reality, all these synonymous terminologies and words that we find are all sending home one message. Kullu man alayha fan wa yabqa wajhu rabbika dhul jalali wal ikram. Everything upon this earth will perish. Everything in the heavens will perish as well. Wa yabqa wajhu rabbika dhul jalali wal ikram. The only thing that will remain will be the sublime face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that should be the intent of the believer in striving hard to return back to the akhirah, living upon this earth. وَلَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُسْتَقَرٌ وَمَتَاعٌ إِلَىٰ حِينٍ. We're only here on a temporary basis. The real return is back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا وَزِيَادًا. Those individuals who do good, for them there will be an extra bonus will be given to them. That extra bonus will be looking at the sublime face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is the preparation the Muslim begins to make. وَمَا تَدْرِ نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدَى وَمَا تَدْرِ نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتٌ. No soul knows what it will earn tomorrow, and no soul knows in which land it will die. That is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that every soul has to make that journey. So why are so many of us trying to stay away from this reality, or don't want to live up to this reality, that somehow we begin to fall short? Unfortunately, many of us, even personally on a daily basis, that this reality begins to drift away from us. The first time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions kullu nafsin da'ikatul maut, every single soul will taste death, is inside Surah Ali Imran, verse 185, that we find. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions وَإِنَّمَا تُوَفَّوْنَ أُجُورَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And then you will be given your full recompense, will be given to you on the day of judgment. No individual will be oppressed on that day. فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازْ وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاءُ الْغُرُورِ. Whoever is saved from the punishment of the hellfire and thrown into paradise, فَقَدْ فَازْ. That is the ultimate success. That is the most successful individual, who saved from the punishment of hell and thrown straight into paradise. And then comes the key element regarding this dunya, وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاءُ الْغُرُورِ. What is this world except for a great big deception? That's all that this dunya, this earth is. These sha'a'ir, these symbols, are the symbols of the people who reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَقَالُوا مَا هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا وَمَا يُهْلِكُنَا إِلَّا الدَّهَرُ. These are symbols and slogans of these individuals. Atheists, people who reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, people who speak ill of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, speak ill of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Life for them has only become this dunya. They say, what is this life? Except for that we live and we die. And the only thing that will destroy us is the passing of time. Let us enjoy our life. Let us live life to the maximum. Forget about this reality or this return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So thus the Muslim is vigilant not to fall into this trap of thinking that life is only about remaining here. Those individuals have been described inside the Quran. يَعْلَمُونَ ظَاهِرًا مِّنَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ عَنِ الْآخِرَةِ هُمْ غَافِلُونَ. These people only know the external factors of this world. That's all that they know, everything about this dunya. As for the akhirah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes these individuals as being ghafilun. The second time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the identical verse, kullu nafsin da'ikatul maut, every single soul will taste death, is inside Surah Al-Anbiya, the 21st chapter of the Quran, verse number 35. وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً وَإِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Then we will test you with difficulties, with hardships, with evil, and likewise with goodness, with good things. ثُمَّ إِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Then you will return back to us. Obviously being tested with difficulties quite clear. But how about the good things? Even the good things that a person possesses can unfortunately become at times a distraction for the individual. Take a person away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make a person lose that focus and that return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions something similar again, inside Surah Al-Ankabut, the 29th chapter of the Quran, some verse 57, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ دَاعِكَةُ الْمَوْتِ ثُمَّ إِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Once again, every soul will taste death, and then you'll all return back to us. So what should the Muslim be preaching in their life? Every single individual should be preaching that there is a return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, irrespective of what your status is, what your condition is. Every Muslim should be channeling themselves and channeling those people around them to get prepared for that journey to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But unfortunately we find that the Quran describes, and how truthful the Quran is, that at times we think that the Quran is talking about a separate group of individuals, when the Quran is actually addressing us. قُلْ إِنَّ الْمَوْتَ الَّذِي تَفِرُّونَ مِنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ ثُمَّ تُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ عَالِمِ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَةِ فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. Quran is quite explicit, it's quite clear. For some of us, we begin to fall into a trap. There may be some of us can begin to avoid this return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Quran talks about those individuals, but the message is quite clear towards us as well. قُلْ إِنَّ الْمَوْتَ الَّذِي تَفِرُّونَ مِنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ. Say that death that you are trying to flee away from, that somehow you're trying to escape death, somehow you're trying to avoid death, some way you're trying to run away from death. فَإِنَّهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ. Indeed, it will meet you. It will come straight in front of your face. ثُمَّ تُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ عَالِمِ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَةِ فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. Then you return back to the one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who knows the open and the hidden, knows the external and the internal. ثُمَّ يُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inform every single one of us about what we carried out or the actions that we done upon this earth. Likewise, you find those individuals who fall into that trap. قُلْ إِنْ كَانَتْ لَكُمُ الدَّارُ الْآخِرَةُ خَالِصَةً عِنْدَ اللَّهِ خَالِصَةً مِنْ دُونِ النَّاسِ فَتَمَنَّوا الْمَوْتَ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Those individuals fall into that trap who believe that the akhirah, the final abode, is specific to them. So look how the Quran begins to address these individuals. فَتَمَنَّوُ الْمَوْتِ. Aspire for death. If you believe that you are the chosen ones of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why don't you make that plea that may death come upon us? And we know the context of who these ayat is referring to, but that doesn't concern us today. But apply that lesson towards us. How many of us that we begin to think that we are the chosen ones of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we are Muslims, we are blessed to be born in a Muslim home, or we have a Muslim family around us. So why do many of us still begin to flee away from death? Why don't we aspire for death if we truly are those individuals who have been selected and chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Likewise, those of us individuals who begin to think that somehow we can fortify ourselves from death, we can conceal ourselves from death, we can protect ourselves from death. The Quran mentions, أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يُدْرِكُمُ الْمَوْتِ وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدًا. Wherever you are, death will come and collect you. Even if you happen to be inside your fortified palaces and mansions. That's what some individuals, they begin to think. That somehow they're free from death. Maybe they have some special privilege. Maybe death will give them a certain respect or certain honor. Wherever you happen to be, when your appointed time comes, when your ajal comes, then your return will be taken by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't think fortified palaces, mansions, lofty buildings,
whatever it may be, whether even to build a hospital underneath your palace, as some of these individuals have done, literally they've built them, thinking as soon as a heart attack comes upon us, we can quickly be taken down to the operation theater and then we can save our lives. Your time comes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take your time whenever it happens to be. Whether it happens to be inside that palace or wherever it may be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take those individuals, take all of us and return us back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus we find that likewise those of us who think or begin to fall into the trap that our wealth and our property and our children become a distraction for some of us. That's the Quran mentions towards the end of Surah Al-Munafiqun, talking about the hypocrites, but then mentioning a lesson to us believers. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُلْهِكُمْ أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَلَا أَوْلَادُكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Oh, you believe, don't let your wealth and your children distract you from the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here is carrying a general meaning, but ulama of tafsir have mentioned the deeper meaning is distracts you from the prayer. Your children and your wealth take you away from establishing the prayer. Until eventually that we find that those individuals, وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَٰلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. Whoever lets their wealth and their children distract them from the prayer and devotion towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then those individuals are the manifest losers. They have fallen into a state of loss. وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتِ. Spend from that which you've provided upon you and bestowed upon you, blessed upon you, before it comes upon you, مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتِ, before death comes upon one of you. فَيَقُولَ رَبِّي لَوْلَا أَخَّرْتَنِي إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ قَرِيبٍ فَأَصَدَّقَ وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ وَلَنْ يُؤَخِّرَ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهَا وَاللَّهُ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. One of us is going to begin to say, or most of us are going to begin to say, oh my Lord, return me back into this world, so I may begin to do what? فَأَصَدَّقَ وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. I begin to give the charity, I begin to become righteous, I begin to do good deeds. But we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that once your time, once again, ajal, your appointed time of death comes, وَلَنْ يُؤَخِّرَ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهَا وَاللَّهُ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Once your appointed time comes, there's going to be no returning back to this dunya. There's going to be no return. Once you've left your time, you've left this world, then that is it for that individual. And thus you find many individuals are going to make that statement, as you find inside Surah Al-Mu'minun, that some people are going to say, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتِ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتِ كَلَّا إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَائِلُهَا. Some individual is going to say, when the time, ajal comes once again, oh my Lord, give me respite, give me some time, give me the opportunity to return back to this dunya. What will be said to this individual? كَلَّا إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَائِلُهَا. These are empty words, these are vain words, they have no value today. You had ample opportunity to live true to these words, to live up to these words, but these words don't mean anything now. Now you find a barzakh, an interspace we place between this individual, between this dunya, and likewise towards the akhirah. Just like a person can never return back to the womb of his mother, and likewise a person can never return back to this dunya once a person is taken out this dunya. So there's no concept in Islam that a person can return back, or a person has a second opportunity or a second chance. The person only has one chance upon this dunya, and as a person makes the best of that chance upon this earth. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as much as you can. And as we find likewise many ahadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, remember أَكْثِرُوا مِنْ ذِكْرِ هَادِمِ اللَّذَّاتِ أَوْ هَادِمَ اللَّذَّاتِ. Remember the destroyer of pleasures. In the Sunnah of Imam Tirmidhi that we find, that which destroys the pleasures. The pleasures could be the good things as we mentioned. The pleasures of this dunya, what will destroy them? What will take a person away from all of the good things that we enjoy inside this dunya? It will be nothing but death. So a person needs to become excessively remembering. That is a reality that many of us that we forget. Remember it excessively, that which will destroy the pleasures that we enjoy on a daily basis when we return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus we find prepared for death, that a person who comes in the morning may come in the morning as a believer, and by the end of the day may become, unfortunately, a disbeliever. And a person at night may go to sleep as a kafir, disbeliever. ويصبح مؤمنا, and wakes up as a believer. وخذ من صحتك من مرضك وخذ من حياتك قبل موتك. Take from your health before you fall ill. Take from your life before death comes upon you. It's something, key elements of teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thus we find a long hadith of Al-Bara ibn Azib talking about the journey of the good soul and the journey of the wicked soul. That is a long hadith that all of us should go back, heenin ba'da heen, go back and read this hadith and study this hadith about what will happen to every single one of us. Which type of soul are we going to be on that day when we're extracted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the angels? Thus you find that the good soul, the soul that tried to exert its efforts to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, angels will come down with shrouds from paradise, a white shroud, with a perfume, with a good fragrance, and begin to take this soul out in a soft manner. Just like you squeeze a bottle or a flask, you find how quickly the water just gushes out. This is how the good soul will be squeezed slightly, and it will be brought out. يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّةِ ارْجِعِي إِلَى رَبِّكِ رَاضِيَةً مَرْضِيَّةً فَادْخُلِي فِي عِبَادِي وَادْخُلِي جَنَّتِي. The soul in a state of contentment, in peace, in tranquility, felicity, in bliss, in contentment, taken out easily, return back to your Lord. Return back in a state of happiness. Enter amongst my servants and enter into my paradise. That is the ultimate soul that all of us should be yearning to create that within our soul. And thus you find the soul will come out in an easy manner, in a soft manner. And then you find as this soul is being lifted, you find this soul will be called by every single good name it is known upon inside this dunya. And all of the angels begin to praise this soul until it comes to the lofty location, the record of Al-Illiyun, where only the lofty souls are stored or the names are deposited there. And after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows clearly which soul will enter in that location. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask, who is this good soul? And we said, this is the soul, the son of so-and-so, who's come to his destination. Then we're told to return back into this dunya, because indeed we created you from the earth. We made you reside upon the earth, and we resurrect you once again from the earth. So the soul will travel back down once again. And this time you find when the soul is placed inside the grave, then we ask those questions that all of us know what the answers are today. Who is your Lord? And a good soul will say that my Lord is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ ثَابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ وَيُدِلُّ اللَّهُ الظَّالِمِينَ وَيَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. We find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, will give ithbat to those true believers upon this earth. Al-Qawlu Thabit, as Imam Al-Sa'di mentions in his tafsir, Al-Qawlu Thabit, Qawlu La Ilaha Illallah. Whoever lives according to La Ilaha Illallah, wa mata ala dhalik, dies upon that, resurrected upon that. That is tawfiq min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those individuals will have success inside this dunya and likewise inside the akhirah as well. Inna alladhina qalu rabbuna Allah, thumma istaqamu, tatanazzalu alayhim al-malaika, alla takhafu, wa la tahzanu, وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوَعَدُونَ نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاءُكُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. Those are the individuals that the angels will come down upon those individuals and greet them. Those who say, our Lord is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا, remain steadfast upon that. There's no fear, no grief upon them. Angels will greet them. We are your friends. We were your friends inside this dunya, and we are your friends inside the akhirah. وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي أَنفُسُكُمْ وَلَكُمْ فِيهَا مَا تَدَّعُونَ نُزُلًا مِّنْ غَفُورٍ رَحِيمٍ. You will have whatever your soul desires. Whatever you desire inside this dunya will now be given to you inside the akhirah. So that's the Muslim who controls his soul. As-sabr عن الشهوات. The person who controls their soul not to enter into temptation inside this dunya. Those temptations, those desires will no longer be temptation desires inside the akhirah. Whatever the soul yearns for will be given inside the akhirah towards these righteous individuals. Thus those individuals will be able to say that our Lord is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those individuals are going to be able to say that my way of life is al-Islam. Inna ad-deena 'inda Allahi al-Islam. The way of life in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Islam. Al-Istislam, submission, total submission. Oh, you believe? Udkhulu fi silmi kafatan ولا تتبعوا خطوات الشيطان. Or you believe, enter into Islam in total submission. That is what a Muslim is, exerting his or her efforts in everything, trying to live according to Islam. Whoever seeks any other way of life other than Islam will never be accepted from an individual. وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And inside the Akhirah will be amongst the losing individuals. That is the life of Al-Islam. الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. This day I have chosen for you, perfected it for you, and I'm content and happy for you to follow the way of Al-Islam. That is what a Muslim is searching for. A Muslim who lived according to Islam inside their life will be able to say, Dini al-Islam, my way of life is al-Islam. And likewise, how do you know that? Person read the Quran, person lived by the Quran, that person adopted the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, adorned themselves inside that life, is able to recognize this is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, begins to revive his sunan, begins to revive his practices. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. You claim to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As many of us Muslims, we claim, فَاتَّبِعُونِي. Make ittiba' of the Rasul, of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every day we shred his sunnah. Every day we take go away from his sunnah. Every day we speak ill of his sunnah. Every day we undermine his sunnah. And then we say that we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This ayah has a condition. You love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fattabi'uni. That's the jawab. That's the answer. Follow me. And what's the result that we've given to you? The result is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will begin to love you and wipe out your sins. That's how simple al-Islam is. These individuals are their grave. They'll be shown that if you had disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this would have been your place inside Jahannam. But because you find you exerted your efforts, you tried your best, this is your place inside paradise. And that's the fragrance of paradise will be exposed to these individuals. The place in paradise will be shown to these individuals. These people will say, oh my Lord, hasten the day, hasten the opportunity that I may enter into paradise and return back into my family. Then he said to this individual, sleep a peaceful sleep, just like the person on the first day of the best of his life sleeps with no worries at all. That will be the best of individuals. وَأَمَّا فَاجِرْ وَفَاسِقْ. The rebellious individual, the one who disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his soul will be ripped out. His soul will be ripped out like a fork he's taken out of a hot substance. And this soul will be covered with an evil shroud, with a shroud that leaves a foul smell. And by every wicked name upon this dunya, every wicked name upon this dunya, this individual will be called. And the angels take this soul, but his soul will never be lifted up, because you find that soul, that wicked soul, that evil soul, never will it enter into paradise until the camel goes through the eye of the needle. Mustahil, abadan, never will a wicked, disbelieving individual enter into paradise. Just like the camel can never go through the eye of the needle. And likewise, those are the individuals that you find, those who people who committed shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will begin to be thrown from the heavens. فَتَخْتَفُهُ الطَّيْرِ أَوْ تَحْوِي بِهِ رِيحٌ فِي مَكَانٍ سَحِيقٍ. Inside Surah Al-Hajj that we find, thrown down from the heavens. Those people commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ulama tafaseed it mention, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention a person be thrown down from the heavens? Because you find shirk is only بُعْدًا عَنِ اللَّهِ subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shirk takes you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shirk does not bring you close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those individuals who think that the path of shirk will bring them close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anwa' al-shirk, all the forms of shirk. That's why some of the ulama mention, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرِكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاء. Some ulama mention, كُلُّ أَنْوَاعُ الشِّرْك, every form of shirk, وَلَوْ كَانَ كَبِيرًا أَوْ قَلِيلًا, any form of shirk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never ever forgive it. وَهُمْ أَقِلَّا. They're a minority view of the ulama, but there's some truthful inside some element of their words, that every element of shirk is dangerous for the believer. وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَوْهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. The actions that some of these people bring, even this ayah is talking about the mushrikun, the disbelieving individuals, but a Muslim should be wary about that. That some individuals, we're going to bring their actions of their judgment, and we're going to throw them like scattered dust on a windy day. There will be no value for those individuals. And that could be the state of these individuals, these wicked souls, disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't want to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ample opportunity, ample signs have been given to these individuals. And thus you find this individual be thrown down upon the earth. And then you find this person will be hit. And that pain we heard, or that voice we heard by everything, every living thing except for the human being. And thus you find this individual, when this individual asked exactly the same question, what will this individual say? La adri, la adri. I don't know, I don't know. I heard the people saying something, but I was not able to say it. That could be many of us individuals. All of us know what the answer is today. But if you don't have that tawfiq min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're not going to be able to utter those words. You're not able to say, my Lord is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My way of life is Islam. The messenger sent to me was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I heard some people saying these words, but today I can't comprehend them. Today I can't understand them. I don't know what to say. Kadhabta, you lied. You're a liar, that's what you are. وَإِنْ يَرَوْ كُلَّ آيَةٍ لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِهَا. Some of us, we see every single sign, we're never going to submit. We're never going to come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's an evil soul. The believing soul is that individual, or the Muslim ala aqal, sees all of the different signs, sees the reality of every single day. A time, a portion is taken away. Every day is a part of your body that's being disseminated. It's taken away from you. There's not much time left of every single individual. So how come we become those foolish individuals who begin to think that we can stay away from death? And thus we find Allah mentioned quite clearly inside Surah Al-Mulk, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created death and then life. Never mentioned life first, because the essence is quite clear, as ulama tafsir have mentioned, that there is more of a reality of death. That there will be death. Everything that is born will taste the death. And that's to see that what you reside upon this earth, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, to see which of you is going to do the best of actions. Who amongst us is going to strive to do the correct actions? That's how simple life is. It's as black and white. That's how simple Islam is. These are the actions that you need to do. You need to exert yourselves to try to do these actions to get into paradise. Yes, at times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can overlook the actions. At times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive any individual He wants. يُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. Forgives whomever He wants, punishes whomever He wants. But so many of us have become full of ourselves, that perhaps I live a dangerous life. I live an evil life. I live a life of disobedience, a life of corruption. And perhaps I may be that one individual that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pardons or forgives. That's a dangerous life to live, to think that you could be that one individual and to rely solely upon that and exert no effort, try nothing inside this dunya. Read through all of the ahadith which talk about paradise. Lahul Jannah, wajabat lahul Jannah, ghurisat lahu fil Jannah, dakhal al Jannah, adman lahu fil Jannah. He will have this in paradise. I guarantee this for him in paradise. He'll be promised this in paradise. This will be planted in paradise. We'll enter paradise. This will be given in paradise. Go and study all of those ahadith. All those ahadith, you find what? Nothing but a'mal. You find actions. Person says this, will have this plant in paradise. Person does this, will have this in paradise. Person stays away from this, is guaranteed this inside paradise. So who says that actions don't have a pivotal role for a Muslim inside their life? So Muslims shouldn't become shallow in their actions. Yes, we're going to fall short inside our actions. وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ دَعِيفًا. Man has been created inside a state of weakness. We'll err, we'll make mistakes. But the key element is the real believer is the one who's trying inside this dunya. He's striving inside this dunya. وَلَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. Man will only have whatever he strives for. Whatever you strive for is what you'll be given to. And you'll see your striving. Whoever strives for the akhirah and makes that striving for towards the akhirah, we'll see فَسَعْيَهُ كَانَ سَعْيَ مَشْكُورًا. Indeed, that sa'i of that individual will be something a rewardful, with something beneficial for that individual who makes that true sa'i. Likewise, you find that individual فَلَنُحْيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا, will give that individual a good life. And thus you find Shaykh Sami Taymiyyah mentioned مَنْ لَمْ يَدْخُلْ يَنِي الْجَنَّةَ الدُّنْيَا لَمْ يَدْخُلْ جَنَّةَ الْآخِرَةَ. Whoever doesn't enter the paradise of this world, will never enter the paradise of the Akhirah. Where is the paradise inside this world? There is no paradise inside this world. The paradise inside this world is right here inside your heart. If you find it right inside your heart, you find that contentment, you find that peace, you find that tranquility, you find halawatul iman, you find submission, you find contentment, you find bliss, you find happiness, you found paradise inside your heart, then inshallah you found paradise inside the Akhirah. That's how simple life is. You find it inside your heart, then inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bestow and bless you with that further Akhirah, the real Akhirah inside the Akhirah. Irrespective, then whatever your actions may be, irrespective whatever your life may be then, that is a search that we all need to begin to find and to develop. To stay away from falling into that shallow understanding of this world, of loving, excessive love of this dunya. Not to say the dunya is not important, but to take that away from our heart and begin to strive for the Akhirah in that death that we all have to meet, and each one of us has to prepare our own selves. That is a time whereby every Muslim needs to become selfish. That what have I prepared for the Akhirah? The son of Adam dies, everything comes to a standstill. Or you find before that, three things travel with all of us towards our graves. فَيَرْجِعِ اثنان وَيَبْقَ وَاحِدٌ. Two of them will return back. Our family members and our wealth will return back. وَيَبْقَ وَاحِدٌ. One thing will remain with every single one of us. What will remain with every single one of us? وَيَبْقَ عَمَلُهُ. The only thing that will remain will be our actions. Simple. That's every single one of us. And likewise, we find three things will benefit an individual when they leave this dunya. It'll either be a righteous son, a righteous daughter, a righteous progeny that will begin, وَلَدٌ صَالِحٌ يَدْعُ لَهُ, begin to pray for us. We don't want to live a life of Islam. We don't want our children to live a life of Islam. Encourage them to come towards Islam. So then eventually they will begin to pray for us. It becomes an ongoing reward for us individuals. Likewise, you find some form of sadaqah, some form of charity. As we heard, مَنْ بَنَى لِلَّهِ مَسْجِدًا بَنَى اللَّهُ لَهُ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever builds a house for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build a house for an individual inside paradise. That is one of the ways of ongoing charity. To build a masjid, to build an orphanage, to build an institute, to build a madrasa, to repair the road, to repair a well, to bring out water, whatever, all types of charitable actions. These are ways that will benefit the individual inside the Akhirah. And likewise you find some knowledge a person leaves behind, that people can benefit from that knowledge, or some form of creating avenues of knowledge. Our many wasail are clearly there, whether it be printing the Quran, printing of kutub, of books, of durus, of halaqat, whatever it may be. It's all forms of way of leaving behind knowledge that people can begin to benefit from. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq, all the ability, all the wasail, all the opportunities to begin to prepare for that long journey, for that difficult journey. It will only be swift for those individuals who begin to understand that journey is not really a long journey. It's not really a long tunnel. It is a short tunnel. It is a short journey. The person begins to take that long journey inside this dunya, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may shorten that journey inside the Akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala place these words inside our mizan of hasanat and make us amongst those individuals, الَّذِينَ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنَهُ, who hear the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and don't just hear them, but comprehend them, understand them, and implement them to the best of the ability. وَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِجَمِيعِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. بارك الله فيكم.
Jazakallah khair, Ustad, for the lecture on reality of death. We have a few minutes, inshallah, before Isha Salah. Just like to ask if there's any questions related with the topic that you've just heard from the brothers. Okay, we have one. Just before we ask that question, if Brother Maqsood is around, I know there was a question that was coming from the sister, so if that's around, if we can have that on a piece of paper. Jazakallah khair.
Every single living thing will hear the noise, okay, except from the human being. Does that include the jinn as well?
Yes. My brother's asking a question when I more accurately be when the soul will be barakallahu fi. When the soul will be hit inside the grave, then everything will hear, you need the sound except for the human being. As for the jinn, wallahu a'lam, ma'indi ilm, I don't know, maybe Sheikh or somebody else can highlight whether the jinn will hear that sound as well. But every living thing will hear that sound except for human beings. And thus you find that Sheikh Samir Taymiyyah, he writes that those people who are suffering inside their graves, that we used to take when the animals are suffering from an upset stomach, we would take them to the graveyard. And when they have a convulsion, the moving of their stomach, because the sounds that we're hearing, that would clear up their stomachs, etc. is an action that they used to do, that Sheikh Samir Taymiyyah has mentioned in some of his works. Wallahu a'lam.
Is there anybody else? Jazakallah. Yes, brother.
Should he be forgiven? The brother's asking a question, can a shaheed be given forgiven if they commit shirk? Wallahu a'lam. Akhi, at the end, there's not for us to judge any individual. But if the person died upon clear shirk and it's absolute crystal clear, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge that individual. Even then, it's not for us to say if a person commits shirk that a person is definitely going into the hellfire because they're Muslim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Maybe there could have been some obstacles, it could have been something that's there. We can only give a general answer. So shaheed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may pick up that individual for some element of sincerity inside in their life, sacrificing themselves, the environment that they lived in, they were not exposed to the true belief, they did not understand what the correct aqidah was. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge that individual. It's not for us to judge any individual and to say specifically this person will go into paradise and this person will go into the hellfire. We are only making a general statement. People who commit shirk in general, they are heading towards the hellfire. As for specifically, in هذا شخص بعينه, this individual will go into Jahannam, then no individual can make that statement. Wallahu a'lam.
Jazakallah. Just one last question, brother.
Brother, when the person dies, people say, the relative, don't cry, the soul will get hurt. What's the reality?
That's right. The brother asked the question that some people say when the soul dies, that don't cry, it will harm the dead individual. Here, what we mean by crying is excessive, wailing and crying. As for natural crying and the shedding of tears, then there's nothing wrong with that. But when people become excessive of slapping their cheeks and ripping their clothing and wailing and crying, because we find in the masabr and the sadmatil ula, indeed patience is when the calamity first hits you, that you are patient. Not at a later stage, you become patient and you begin to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it first happens, you're praising, you say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. That is the meaning. At that key element, you begin to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So some of our people is excessive wailing and crying. According to authentic ahadith, this affects the dead person. It harms a dead person. So the appropriate sunnah is to remind our family members, there's nothing wrong with crying in a humble manner or something which is natural, but to go beyond the bounds, which many of the women begin to do, that you can hear their voices and screaming and shouting, or words of kufr come out their mouths, that this person was too young, why did Allah take their life, it wasn't their appointed time, they had a lot of life to go, they had a young life, they had a young son, a young family, a young wife, or a young husband, whatever it may be, all these type of words, a person should avoid them and stay away from them, and remind their family members to have patience, and you are actually harming the dead individual. Likewise, to quickly swiften and bury the individual is an appropriate sunnah, whereby we begin to visualize the face of the individual. There's no benefit in seeing the face of the individual. There's no benefit. That which was ascribed to seeing the blessed face of the Prophet Muhammad is something specific. As for waiting on hours on end for a person to come and see the face, لا يضر إيمانه ولا يزيد إيمانه. It doesn't affect the iman of the individual, it doesn't increase the iman. But sometimes medically the person, their bodily organs may have taken, there may be some facial features which have changed. So some people want to visualize some form of nur or some depiction on the person's face. That's not totally true. That's not true. So swift, the sunnah is to bury the person appropriately and quick as possible. If they're a good individual, you want to take them towards the akhirah. If they're a bad individual, you want to take away that burden on your shoulders and quickly bury this individual to take away that sin that could be on our shoulders. Wallahu a'lam.